Speak!
'Tis God and will not answer.
'Tis strange. Let us impart what we have seen tonight unto young Hamlet. For upon my life, this spirit, dumb to us, will speak to him.
Though yet of Hamlet, our dear brother's death, the memory be grieving, and that it is us befitted to bear our hearts in grief, and our whole kingdom to be contracted under one brow of woe, yet so far hath discretion fought with nature, that we with wisest sorrows think on him, together with remembrance of ourselves. Therefore, our sometime sister, now our queen, the imperial jointress to this warlike state, have we, as 'twere with a defeated joy, with a dropping and auspicious eye, with mirth in funeral, with dirge in marriage, an equal scale, weighing delight and dole, taken to wife. Nor have we herein barred your better wisdoms, which have freely gone with this affair along, for all our thanks. And now, Laertes, what's the news with you? You told us of some suit. What wast thou have, Laertes? You cannot speak of reason to the Dane and lose your tongue. What wouldst thou beg, Laertes? The head is not more native to the heart than is the throne of Denmark to thy father. What wouldst thou have, Laertes?
My dread lord, your leave and favor to return to France, from whence though willingly I came to Denmark to show my duty in your coronation, yet now I must confess that duty done, my thoughts and wishes bend again toward France and bow them to your gracious leave and pardon.
Have you your father's leave? What says Polonius?
He hath, my lord, wrung from me my slow leave by laborsome petition, and at last, upon his will, I sealed my hard consent. I beseech you give him leave to go.
Take thy fair hour, Laertes, time be thine, and thy best graces, spend it at thy will. And now, my son, and my cousin Hamlet.
A little more than kin and less than kind.
How is it that the clouds still hang on you?
Not so, my lord, I am too much in the sun.
Good Hamlet, cast thy nighted color off, and let thine eye look like a friend on Denmark. Do not forever with thy veiled lids seek for thy noble father in the dust. Thou know'st 'tis common. All that lives must die, passing through nature to eternity.
Aye, madam, it is common.
If it be, why seems it so particular with thee?
Seems, madam. Nay, it is. I know not seems. 'Tis not my inky cloak, good mother, nor customary suits of solemn black, no, nor the fruitful river in the eye that can denote me truly. These indeed seem, for they are actions that a man might play. But I have that within which passes show. These but the trappings and the suits of woe.
'Tis sweet and commendable in your nature, Hamlet, to give these mourning duties to your father. But you must know, your father lost a father. That father lost his, and the survivor bound in filial obligation to do some obsequious sorrow. But to persevere in this obstinate condolement is a course of impious stubbornness. 'Tis unmanly grief. We pray you, throw to earth this unprevailing woe, and think of us as of a father. For, let the world take note, you are the most immediate to our throne, and with no less nobility and love than that which dearest fathers bears his sons, do I impart to you. For your intent in going back to school in Wittenberg is most retrograde to our desire, and we beseech you, bend you to remain here in the comfort and cheer of our eye, our chiefest courtier, cousin, and our son.
Let not my mother lose her prayers, Hamlet. I pray thee stay with us. Go not to Wittenberg.
I shall in all my best obey you, madam.
What? 'Tis a loving and a fair reply. Be as ourself in Denmark. Come, madam, away. This gentle and unforced accord of Hamlet's, it's smiling to my heart. In grace whereof, no jocund health that Denmark drinks today, but the great cannon to the cloud shall tell, and the king's rouse shall brew it again, re-speaking earthly thunder. Come, away!
Flesh would melt, thaw, and resolve itself into a dew. Or that the everlasting had not fixed his cannon against self-slaughter. God! How weary, stale, flat, and unprofitable seem to me all the uses of this world. Fie on it! Fie! 'Tis an unweeded garden that grows to seed. Things rank and gross in nature possess it merely that it should come to this. But 2 months dead, nay, not so much, not two, so excellent a king that was to this Hyperion, to a satyr, so loving to my mother that he might not beteem the winds of heaven visit her face too roughly. Heaven and earth must I remember. Why, she would hang on him as if increase of appetite had grown by what it fed on, and yet within a month let me nothing got it. Frailty, thy name is woman. A little month, or ere those shoes were old with which she followed my poor father's body like Niobe, all tears. O God, a beast that one's discourse of reason would have mourned longer, married with my uncle, my father's brother, but no more like my father than I to Hercules. Within a month, ere yet the salt of most unrighteous tears had left the flushing in her galled eye, she married, oh, most wicked speed, to post with such dexterity to incestuous sheets. It is not, nor it cannot come to good. But break my heart, for I must hold my tongue.
Hail to your lordship.
I'm glad to see thee well. Horatio! For I do forget myself.
Say, my lord and your poor servant ever.
Sir, my good friend, I'll change that name with you. And what make you from Wittenberg, Horatio? Marcellus!
My good lord!
I am very glad to see you, Horatio. Good even, sir. But what in faith make you from Wittenberg?
True in disposition, good my lord.
I would not hear your enemies say so, nor shall you do that might hear that violence to make it a truster of your own report against yourself. I know you are no truant, but what is your affair in Elsinore? We'll teach you to drink deep ere you depart.
My lord, I came to see your father's funeral.
I prithee, do not mock me, fellow student. I think it was to see my mother's wedding.
Indeed, it followed hard upon.
Thrift, thrift, Horatio, the funeral baked meats did coldly furnish forth the marriage tables. Would I had met my dearest foe in heaven or ever I'd seen that day, Horatio. My father, methinks I see my father.
Where, my lord?
In my mind's eye, Horatio.
I saw him once. He was a goodly king.
He was a man, taken for all and all. I shall not look upon his life again.
My lord, I think I saw him yesternight.
Saw who?
My lord, the king, your father.
The king, my father.
Season your admiration for a while with an attent ear, till I may deliver upon the witness of these gentlemen this marvel to you.
For God's love, let me hear.
Two nights together had these gentlemen, Marcellus and Bernardo, on their watch in the dead waste and middle of the night, been thus encountered. A figure like your father appears before them, and with solemn march goes slow and stately by them. This to me in dreadful secrecy in part they did, and I with them the third night kept watch, where as they had delivered, the apparition comes. I knew your father. These hands are not more like.
But where was this?
My lord, upon the platform where we watched.
Did you not speak to it?
My lord, I did, but answer made it none. Yet once methought it lifted up its head and did address itself to motion like as it would speak, but even then the morning cock crew loud, and it shrunk in haste away and vanished from our sight.
'Tis very strange.
As I do live, my honored lord, 'tis true. And I did think it written our duty to let you know of it.
Indeed, sirs. But this troubles me. Hold you the watch tonight?
We do, my lord.
I will watch tonight. Perchance 'twill walk again.
I warrant it will.
If it assume my noble father's person, I'll speak to it, though hell itself should gape and bid me hold my peace. I pray you all, if you have hitherto concealed this sight, let it be tenable in your silence still. And whatsoever else may hap tonight, give it an understanding, but no tongue. I will requite your loves. Very well. Upon the platform, twixt 11 and 12, I'll visit you.
Our duty to your honor.
Your loves is mine to you. Farewell. My father's spirit, all is not well. I fear some foul play. But the night were calm, and until then, sit still, my soul. Foul deeds will rise, though all the earth o'erwhelm them to men's eyes.
The trifling of his favor, hold it a fashion and a toy in blood, a violet, in the youth of primy nature, forward, not permanent, sweet, not lasting. The perfume and suppliance of a minute, no more.
No more, but so.
Think it, no more. Perhaps he loves you now, but you must fear his greatness weighed. His will is not his own, for he himself is subject to his birth. He may not, his unvalued persons do, carve for himself, for on his choice depends the sanity and health of this whole state. And therefore must his choice be circumscribed unto the voice and yielding of that body whereof he is the head. Then, if he says he loves you, it fits your wisdom no farther to believe it than the main voice of Denmark goes withal. Then weigh what loss your honor may sustain if with too credent ear you list his songs, or lose your heart, or your chaste treasure open to his unmastered importunity. Fear it, Ophelia, fear it, my dear sister, and keep you in the rear of your affection, out of the shot and danger of desire. Be wary, then. Best safety lies in fear.
I shall the effect of this good lesson keep as watchman to my heart, but good, my brother, do not as some ungracious pastors do, show me the steep and thorny way to heaven whilst like a puffed and reckless libertine himself the primrose path of dalliance treads and recks not his own reed.
Oh, fear me not. I stay too long. But here my father comes.
Yet here, Laertes. Aboard, aboard, for shame. The wind sits at the shoulder of your sail and you are stayed for. Farewell, my blessing with thee. And these few precepts in thy memory, look thou character. Give thy thoughts no time. Be thou familiar, but by no means vulgar. The friends thou hast, and their adoption tried, grapple them unto thy soul with hoops of steel. Give every man thy ear, but few thy voice. Take each man's censure, but reserve thy judgment. Neither a lender nor a borrower be, for loan oft loses both itself and friend, and borrowing dulls the edge of husbandry. But this above all, to thine own self be true, and it must follow as the night, the day, thou canst not then be false to any man. Farewell. My blessing season this in thee.
Most humbly do I take my leave, my lord.
The time invests you. Go.
Farewell, Ophelia, and remember well what I've said to you.
'Tis in my memory locked, and you yourself shall keep the key of it.
Farewell.
What is it, Ophelia, that he hath said to you?
So please you, something touching the Lord Hamlet.
Mary, well bethought. 'Tis told of me he hath a very late given private time to you, and you yourself have of your audience been most free and bounteous. Now, if it be so, as so 'tis put on me, and that in way of caution, I must tell you, you do not understand yourself so clearly as it behooves my daughter and your honor. What is it between you? Give me up the truth.
He hath, my lord, of late made many tenders of his affections towards me.
Affections? You speak like a green girl unsifted in such perilous circumstances. Do you believe these tenders, as you call them?
I do not know, my lord, what I should think.
Mary, I will teach you. Think yourself a baby, that you have ta'en these tenders for true pay, which are not sterling.
My lord, he hath importuned me with love in an honorable fashion.
Aye, fashion you may call it. Go
and,
to.
And hath given countenance to his speech with almost all the holy vows of heaven.
Aye, springes to catch woodcocks. I do know when the blood burns how prodigal the soul lends the tongue baths. These blazes, daughter, you must not take for fire. From this time be something scanter of your maiden presence. For Lord Hamlet, believe so much in him that he is young, and with a larger tether may he walk than may be given you. In few, Ophelia, do not believe his vows. They do beguile. I would not, in plain terms, from this time forth, have you so slander any moment's leisure as to give words or talk with the Lord Hamlet. Look to it, I charge you. Come your ways.
I shall obey, my lord.
The air bites shrewdly. It is very cold.
It is a nipping and an eager air.
What hour now?
I think it lacks of 12.
No, it is struck.
Indeed, I heard it not.
Look, my lord!
comes.
Be thy intents, wicked or charitable, thou com'st in such a questionable shape that I will speak to thee. I'll call thee King, Hamlet, Father, Royal Dane. Oh, answer me. Let me not burst in ignorance, but tell why in the sepulchre where we saw thee quietly entombed hath oped his ponderous and marble jaws to cast thee up again. What may this mean? Say, why is this? Wherefore, what should we do?
Do not go with it, no, by no means.
It will not speak, then I will follow it.
Do not, my lord.
Why? What should be the fear? I do not set my life at a pin's fee, and for my soul, what can it do to that being a thing as immortal as itself? It waves me forth again. I'll follow it. Go on, I'll follow thee.
You shall not go, my lord.
Hold up your hands.
Fool, you shall not go.
My face cries out. It takes each petty artery in my body as hardy as the fiercest lion's nerve. Still I go. Stand ahead to me, gentlemen. By heaven, I'll make a ghost of him that lets me. I say, away. Go on, I'll follow thee.
Go, he waxes desperate with imagination.
Let's follow.
'Tis not fit thus to obey him.
Have after. To what issue will this come?
Something is rotten in the state of Denmark.
Heaven will direct it.
Nay, let's follow him.
I am my father's spirit, doomed for a term to walk the night, and for the day, confined to fast and violence, till the foul crimes done in my days of nature are burnt and purged away. List, list, oh list, if thou didst ever thy dear father love.
Oh God!
Revenge is foul and most unnatural, murder.
Murder!
Murder most foul as in the best it is, but this most foul, strange, and unnatural.
Haste me to know it, that I with wings as swift as meditation or the thoughts of love may sweep to my revenge.
'Tis given that sleeping in my orchard a serpent stung me, so that the whole ear of Denmark is, by fortune process of thy death, rankly abused. But know, thou noble youth, the serpent that had stained my father's life, now wears his crown.
Oh, my prophetic soul! My uncle!
I, that incestuous, that adulterate beast, with witchcraft of his wits, with traitorous gifts, won with shameful lust the will of thy most seeming virtuous queen. But soft, methinks I sense the morning air. Brief let me be. Sleeping within my orchard, my trust of always of the afternoon, in my secure hour, thy uncle's store, with the juice of cursed Lebanon in a vial, and in the porches of my ears did pour the leprous distillment, whose effect holds such an enmity with blood of man that, swift as quicksilver, it courses through the natural gates and alleys of the body. Thus was I, sleeping, by a brother's hand, of life, of crown, of queen, at once dispatched. Let not the royal bed of Denmark be a couch for luxury and damned incest. But howsoever thou pursuest this act, taint not thy mind, nor let thy soul contrive against thy mother aught. Leave her to heaven, and to those thorns that in her bosom lodge to prick and sting her. Fare thee well at once. Adieu! 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 Remember me!
Remember thee! Yes, from the table of my memory I'll wipe away all trivial fond records, and thy commandment all alone shall live within the book and volume of my brain, unmixed with baser matter. Yes, by heaven! most pernicious woman! Oh, villain! Smiling, damned villain, that one may smile and smile and be a villain. At least I'm sure it may be so in Denmark.
My lord! Lord Hamlet!
So be it.
What news, my lord?
Oh, wonderful.
Could my lord tell it?
No! You will reveal it.
Not I, my lord, by heaven.
Nor I, my lord.
Nor I.
How say you then what heart of man once think it? But you'll be secret.
By heaven.
There's never a villain dwelling in all Denmark, but he is an errant knave.
There needs no ghost, my lord, come from the grave to tell us this.
Why, right. You are in the right. And so, without more circumstance at all, I hold it fit that we shake hands and part. You, as your business and desire, shall point you, for every man hath business and desire, such as it is. For my own poor part, I will go pray.
These are but wild and whirling words, my lord.
I am sorry they offend you heartily. Yes, faith, heartily.
There's no offense, my lord.
Yes, by St. Patrick, but there is, Horatio, and much offense too. Touching this vision here, it is an honest ghost, that let me tell you. For your desire to know what is between us, or master it as you may. And now, good friends, as we are friends, scholars and soldiers, give me one poor request.
What is it, my lord? We will.
Never to make known what you have seen tonight.
My lord, we will not.
Nay, but swear it.
In faith, my lord, not I.
Nor I, my lord, in faith.
Nor I, in faith.
Indeed, but swear again, indeed! Consent to swear!
Propose the oath, my lord.
Never to speak of this that you have seen. Swear!
I swear!
Once more remove, good friends.
Day and night, but this... this is wondrous strange.
And as a stranger, give it welcome. There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. Rest. Rest, perturbed spirit. So, gentlemen, with all my love, I do commend me to you. And what so poor a man as Hamlet is may do to express his love and friending to you, God willing, shall not lack. Let us go in together, and still your fingers on your lips, I pray. The time is out of joint. Cursed spite that ever I was born to set it right. Nay, come, let's go together.
My son, this money and these notes, Rinaldo.
I will, my lord.
You shall do marvelous wisely, good Rinaldo, before you visit him to make inquire of his behavior.
My lord, I did intend it.
God buy ye. Fare ye well.
Good, my lord.
Observe his inclination in yourself.
I shall, my lord.
And let him ply his music.
Well, my lord.
Farewell.
How now, Ophelia? What's the matter?
Oh, my lord, I've been so affrighted.
What woman in the name of God?
My lord, as I was sewing in my closet, Lord Hamlet, with his doublet all embraced, no hat upon his head, his stockings fouled, ungartered, and down jived to his ankles. Pale as his shirt, his knees knocking each other, and with a look so piteous in purport as he had been loosed out of hell to speak of horrors, he comes before me.
Mad for thy love?
My lord, I do not know, but truly I do fear it.
What said he?
He took me by the wrist and held me hard. Then goes he to the length of all his arm, and with his other hand thus o'er his brow, he falls to such perusal of my face as he would draw it. Long stayed he so. At last, a little shaking of mine arm, and thrice his head thus waving up and down, he raised a sigh so piteous and profound as it did seem to shatter all his bulk and end his being. That done,
went without their helps, and to the last bended their light on me.
Come, I will go seek the king. This is the very ecstasy of love, whose violent property foredoes itself and leads the will to desperate undertakings as oft as any passion under heaven that does afflict our natures. Sorry, but have you given him any hard words of late?
No, my lord, but as you did command, I did repel his letters and denied him all access to me.
That hath made him mad. I'm sorry that with better heed and judgment I had not quoted him. I feared he did but trifle and meant to rack thee. Come, we go to the king. This must be known. Come!
Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Moreover, that we much did long to see you, the need we have to use you did provoke our hasty sending. Something have you heard of Hamlet's transformation? What it should be, more than his father's death, that thus hath put him so far from the understanding of himself, I cannot dream of. We pray you vouchsafe your time here in our court some little while, so as by your companies to draw him onto pleasure, so much from occasion you may glean, whether aught to us unknown afflicts him thus, that opened lies within our remedy.
Good gentlemen, he hath much talked of you, and sure I am two men there is not living to whom he more adheres. If it will please you to show us so much gentry and goodwill as to expend your time with us a while for the supply and profit of our hope, your visitation shall receive such thanks as fits a king's remembrance.
Both your majesty's might. By the sovereign power you have of us, put your dread pleasures more into command than to entreaty.
But we both obey, and here give up ourselves in the full bent to lay our service freely at your feet to be commanded.
Thanks, dear Rosencrantz and gentle Guildenstern.
Thanks, dear Rosencrantz and gentle Guildenstern. And I beseech you instantly to visit my too much changed sum. Go, one of you, and bring these gentlemen where Hamlet is.
May our presence and our practices be pleasant and helpful to him.
Aye, amen.
Good my liege, I hold my duty as I hold my soul both to my God and to my gracious king, and I do think, or else this brain of mine hunts not the trail of policy so surely as it hath used to, that I have found the very cause of Hamlet's lunacy.
Oh, speak of that! That do I long to hear. He tells me, sweet Gertrude, he hath found the head and source of all your son's distemper.
I doubt it is no other but the main, his father's death and our poor hasty marriage.
Since brevity is the soul of wit, and tediousness the outward limbs and flourishes, I will be brief. Your noble son is mad. Mad call I it, for to define true madness, what is but to be nothing else but mad? But let that go.
More matter with less art.
Madam, I swear I use no art at all. That he is mad, tis true. Tis true, tis pity, and pity tis true. A foolish figure. But farewell it, for we will use no art. Mad let us grant him then. And now remains that we find out the cause of this defect. Or should I say, the cause of this defect. Prepend. I have a daughter, have while she is mine, who, in her duty and obedience, mark, hath given me this. Gather and surmise. To the celestial and my soul's idol, the beautified Ophelia. That is an ill phrase. A vile phrase. Beautified is a vile phrase. But you shall hear. These, in her excellent white bosom, these, etc.
Came this from Hamlet to her?
Madam, do stay a while, I will be faithful. Doubt thou the stars are fire? Doubt that the sun doth move? Doubt truth to be a liar, but never doubt I love. Oh, dear Ophelia, I'm ill at these numbers. I have not art to reckon my groans, but that I love thee best. Oh, most best, believe it. Adieu. Thine evermore, most dear lady, whilst his machine is to him, Hamlet. This, in obedience, hath my daughter shown me.
But how hath she received his love?
What do you think of me?
As of a man faithful and honorable.
And I would fain prove so. But what might you think, had I seen this hot love on the wing, as I perceived it, I must tell you, before my daughter told me, what might you or my queen, your majesty here, think, had I looked upon this love with idle sight? What might you think? No, I went round to work, and to my mistress thus I did bespeak. Hamlet is a lord out of thy star, this cannot be. And then I prescript gave her that she should lock herself from his resort, admit no messengers, receive no tokens, which done, she took the fruits of my advice, and he, repelled, a short tale to make, fell into a sadness, thence into a weakness, thence into a lightness, and by this declension, into the madness wherein he now raves and we all mourn for.
Do you think 'tis this?
It may be, very like.
Take this from this, if this be otherwise.
But how may we try it further?
You know, sometimes he walks 4 hours together here in the lobby.
So he does indeed.
At such a time, I'll loose my daughter to him. Be you and I behind the arras, mark the encounter. If he love her not, and be not from his reason fallen thereon, let me be no assistant for a state, but take a farm in Carter's.
We will try it.
But look where sadly the poor wretch comes reading.
Away! I beseech you both away. I'll board him presently. Oh, give me leave. How does my good Lord Hamlet?
Well, God mercy.
Do you know me, my lord?
Excellent, well, you are a fishmonger.
Not I, my lord.
Then I would you were so honest a man.
Honest, my lord?
Aye, sir. To be honest as this world goes is to be one man picked out of 10,000.
That's very true, my lord.
For if the sun breed maggots in a dead dog, being a good kissing carrion, have you a daughter?
I have, my lord.
Let her not walk in the sun. Conception is a blessing. But as your daughter may conceive, friend, look to it.
How say you by that? Still harping on my daughter. Yet he knew me not at first. He said I was a fishmonger. He is far gone. And yet, in my youth, I suffered much extremity for love very near this. I'll speak with him again. What do you read, my lord?
Words, words, words.
What is the matter, my lord?
Between who?
I mean the matter in which you read, my lord.
Slander, sir. For the satirical rogue says here that old men have gray beards, that their faces are wrinkled, and that they have a plentiful lack of wit. All which, sir, though I most powerfully and potently believe, yet hold it that an honesty to have it thus set down. For yourself, sir, shall grow as old as I am, if like a crab you could go backwards.
Though this be madness, yet there be method in it. Will you walk into the air, my lord?
Into my grave?
Indeed, that said of the air. How pregnant sometime his replies are. A happiness with which often madness hits on, which reason and sanity couldn't be so prosperously be delivered of. I will leave him and suddenly contrive the means of meeting between him and my daughter. My lord, I will take my leave of you.
You cannot, sir, take from me anything that I will not more willingly part with all. Except my life. Except my life! Except my life!
Fare you well, my lord.
These tedious old fools.
You go speak to Lord Hammond? Here he is.
My honored lord!
My most dear lord!
My excellent good friend, how dost thou, Guildenstern? Ah, Rosencrantz. Good lads, how do you both?
As the indifferent children of the earth.
Happy in that we are not over-happy. Yon fortune's cap, we are not the very butt.
Nor the soles of her shoe.
Neither, my lord.
Then you live about her waist, or in the middle of her favors.
Save her privates, we.
In the secret parts of fortune.
Oh, most true. She is a strumpet. What news?
None, my lord. But the world's grown honest.
Then is doomsday near. But your news is not true. Let me question more in particular. What have you, my good friends, deserved at the hands of fortune that she sends you to prison hither?
Prison, my lord.
Denmark's a prison.
Then is the world one?
A goodly one, in which there are many confines, wards, and dungeons, Denmark being one of the worst.
We think not so, my lord.
Why then, 'tis none to you. For there is nothing either good or bad, but thinking it makes it so. To me, it is a prison.
Why, then your ambition makes it one. 'Tis too narrow for your mind.
God, I could be bounded in a nutshell and count myself a king of infinite space. Were it not that I have bad dreams. Shall we to the court? For by my faith, I cannot reason.
We'll wait upon you.
No such matter. I will not sort you with the rest of my servants. But in the beaten way of friendship, what make you at Elsinore?
To visit you, my lord. No other occasion.
Beggar that I am. I am even poor in thanks, but I thank you. Were you not sent for? Is it your own inclining? Is it a free visitation? Come, come. Deal justly with me. Come, come. Nay, speak!
What should we say, my lord?
Anything but to the purpose. You were sent for, and there's a kind of confession in your looks that your modesties have not the craft enough to color. I know the good king and queen have sent for you.
To what end, my lord?
That you must teach me. But let me conjure you, by the rites of our fellowship, be even and direct with me if you are sent for or no.
Sing.
Nay, then I have an eye on you. If you love me, hold not off.
My lord, we were sent for.
I will tell you why. So shall my anticipation prevent your discovery and your secrecy to the king and queen molt no feather. I have of late, but wherefore I know not, lost all my mirth, forgone all custom of exercises, and indeed it goes so heavily with my disposition that this goodly frame of the earth seems to me a sterile promontory. This most excellent canopy of the air, look you, this brave o'erhanging firmament, this majestical roof fretted with golden fire, why, it appeareth nothing to me but a pestilent congregation of vapors. What a piece of work is man. How noble in reason, how infinite in faculties, in form and moving, how express and admirable, in action, how like an angel, in apprehension, how like a god. The beauty of the world, the paragon of animals, and yet to me, what is this quintessence of dust? Man delights not me, nor woman neither, but by your smiling you seem to say so.
My lord. There is no such stuff in my thoughts.
Why did you laugh then when I said man delights not me?
To think, my lord, if you delight not man, oh, what a Lenten entertainment the players shall receive from you. Mm. We got of them on the way, and hither they're coming to offer you service.
He that plays the king shall be welcome.
Huh? There are the players.
Gentlemen, you are welcome in Elsinore. Your hands, come then, you are welcome. But my uncle, father, and aunt, mother are deceived.
In what, my dear lord?
I am but mad north-northwest. When the wind is southerly, I know we'll hop from a handsaw.
Well, we with you, gentlemen.
Hark you, Guildenstern, and you too. That great baby you see there is not yet out of his swaddling clouds.
Happily, he is the second time come to them. They say an old man is twice a child.
I will prophesy he comes to tell me of the players. Mark it.
My lord, I have news to tell you.
My lord, I have news to tell you. When Roscius was an actor in Rome.
The actors are come hither, my lord.
Upon my honor.
Then came each actor upon his ass.
The best actors in the world, either for comedy, tragedy, history, pastoral, pastoral, comical, tragical, pastoral, historical, pastoral, comical, tragical, historical, pastoral, scene, indivisible, and poem unlimited. These are the only men.
Oh, Jephthah, judge of Israel, what a treasure hadst thou?
What treasure had he, my lord?
Why, one fair daughter and no more, the which he loved passing well.
still on my daughter.
Oh, William! Welcome!
Down we go. Hi, friends. Welcome. Heavy, is it?
Yes, it is.
Set it by over there.
Welcome. I'm glad to see thee well. Well, I speak straight. Come, give us a taste of your quality. Come, a passionate speech.
Well, speech, my good lord.
I heard thee speak me a speech once. It was, as I received it, an excellent play. One speech in it I chiefly loved. 'Twas Aeneas' tale to Dido. And thereabout of it, especially when he speaks of Priam's slaughter.
Oh, Dido, queen of Carthage.
If it live in your memory, begin at this line. Let me see, let me see. The rugged Pyrrhus, like the Hyrcanian beast. 'Tis not so. It begins with Pyrrhus. The rugged Pyrrhus, he whose sable arms, black as his purpose, did the knight resemble when he lay couched in the ominous horse, hath now this dread and black complexion smeared with heraldry more dismal, roasted in wrath and fire with eyes like carbuncles, the hellish Pyrrhus, old grandsire Priam seeks. So proceed you.
Oh, God, my lord, well spoken and with good accent and good discretion.
Anon he finds him, striking too short at Greeks, unequal matched Pyrrhus at Priam drives, in reins strikes wide, but with the whiff and wind of his fell sword the unnerved father falls. Then, as a painted tyrant Pyrrhus stood, and like a neutral to his will and matter did nothing. But as we often see against some storm, a silence in the heavens, so after Pyrrhus paused, aroused vengeance sets him new a work, and never did the Cyclops ever fall with less remorse than Pyrrhus' bloody blade now falls on Priam.
This is too long.
Oh. Shout to the barbers with your beard. Prithee, say on.
He's for jig or tail of bawdry, or he sleeps.
Say on, come to Hecuba.
But who? Ah, woe! Who had seen the Moblin Queen, run barefoot up and down the street, threatening the flames with blinding tears, a clout upon that head where late the diadem stood, and for a robe about her length and all her team, her loins, a blanket in the alarm of fear caught up? But if the gods could see her then, as Pyrrhus made malicious sport of mincing her husband's limbs, the instant clamor that she made would have made melt the burning eyes of heaven and bashed it in the gods!
Look where he's not turned his color and his tears in his eyes. I prithee no more.
Tis well. I'll have thee speak out the rest of this soon. Good, my lord, will you see these players well bestowed? Do you hear? Let them be well used, for they are the abstract and brief chronicles of the time.
My lord, I will use them according to their desert.
God's bodkin, man, much better. Use every man after his desert, and who shall escape whipping? Use them after your own honor and dignity. The less they deserve, the more merit is in your bounty. Take them in.
Come, sirs.
Follow him, friends. We'll hear a play tomorrow. Just hear me, old friend. Can you play The Murder of Gonzago?
Aye, my lord.
We'll have tomorrow night. You could, for needs, study a speech of some dozen or 16 lines, which I would set down and insert in it. Could you not?
Aye, my lord.
Very well. Follow that lord, and look you mock him not. My good friends, I'll leave you till night. You are welcome in Elsinore.
Good, my lord.
Aye, so goodbye to you. Now I am alone. Oh, what a rogue and peasant slave am I!
not monstrous that this player here, but in a fiction, in a dream of passion, could force his soul so to his own conceit that from her working, all his visage paled, tears in his eyes, distraction in his aspect, and a broken voice, and his whole function suiting with forms to his conceit? And all for nothing. For Hecuba. What's Hecuba to him or he to her that he should weep for her? What would he do had he the motive and the cue for passion that I have? He would drown the stage with tears and cleave the general ear with poured speech, make mad the guilty and appall the free, confound the ignorant and amaze indeed the very faculties of eyes and ears. Yet I, a dull and muddy-mannered rascal, pink like John of Dreams, unpregnant of my cause, and can say nothing. No. Not for a king upon whose property I most dear life a damned defeat was made. Am I a coward? Zoons, it cannot be, but I am pigeon-livered, and I lack gall to make oppression bitter, or ere this I should have fatted all the region kites with this slave's offal. Body villain! Remorseless! Treacherous! Lecherous! Kindness villain! Why? What an ass am I? This is most brave that I, the son of a dear father murdered, prompted to my revenge by heaven and hell, must like a whore unpack my heart with words and fall a cursing like a very drab, a scullion. Fie upon him. About my brains. I have heard that guilty creatures sitting at a play have, by the very cunning of the scene, been so struck to the soul that presently they proclaim their malefaction. For murder, though it have no tongue, will speak through most miraculous organ. I'll have these players play something like the murder of my father before mine uncle. I'll observe his looks. If he do blench, I'll know my course. The spirit that I have seen may be a devil, and the devil hath power to assume a pleasing shape, yea, and perhaps out of my weakness and my melancholy, as he is very potent with such spirits, abuses me to damn me. I'll have grounds more relative than this. The play's the thing wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king.
He does confess he feels himself distracted, but from what cause he will by no means speak.
Nor do we find him forward to be sounded, but with a crafty madness kept aloof when we would try to bring him on to some confession of his true state.
Did he receive you well?
Most like a gentleman.
But with much forcing of his disposition.
Niggard of question, but of our demands most free in his reply.
Did you essay him to any pastime?
Madam, it so fell out that certain players we overtook on the way, of these we told him, and there did seem in him a kind of joy to hear of it. They're here about the court, and as I think, they have order already this night to play before him.
'Tis most true, and he beseeched me to entreat your majesty to hear and see the matter.
With all my heart, and it doth much content me to hear him so inclined. Good gentlemen, give him a further edge and drive his purposes into these delights.
We shall, my lord.
Sweet Gertrude, leave us too. For we have closely sent for Hamlet hither that he, as for by accident, may hear affront Ophelia. Her father and myself, lawful spies, will so bestow ourselves that seeing unseen, we may of their encounter frankly judge and gather by him, as he is behaved, if it be the affliction of his love or no that thus he suffers for.
I shall obey you. And for your part, Ophelia, I do wish your good beauties be the happy cause of Hamlet's wildness, so shall I hope your virtues will bring him to his wonted way again, to both your honors.
Madam, I wish it may.
Ophelia, walk you here. Gracious, so please you, we will bestow ourselves. Read on this book, that such an exercise may color your loneliness. I hear it coming. Let's withdraw, my lord.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them. To die, to sleep, no more, and by a sleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to, 'tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. To die, to sleep, perchance to dream, aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause. There's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time, the oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pangs of despised love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, and the spurns that the patient merit of the unworthy takes, when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin? Who would fardels bear to grunt and sweat under a weary life, but that the dread of something after death, the undiscovered country from whose born no traveler returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others we know not of? Thus conscience does make cowards of us all, and thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er the pale cast of thought, and enterprises of great pitch and moment with this regard their currents turn awry and lose the name of action. Soft you now, the fair Ophelia. Nymph, in thy orisons be all my sins remembered.
Good, my lord. How does your honor for this many a day?
I humbly thank you. Well, well, well.
My lord, I have remembrances of yours that I have long and longed to re-deliver.
No, not I.
I pray you now receive them.
Not I. I never gave you aught.
My good lord, you know right well you did. And with them words of so sweet breath composed as made the things more rich. Their perfume lost. Take these again, for to the noble mind rich gifts wax poor when givers prove unkind. There, my lord.
Are you honest?
My lord.
Are you fair?
What means your lordship?
That if you be honest and fair, your honesty should admit no discourse to your beauty.
Could beauty, my lord, have better commerce than with honesty?
Aye, truly. For the power of beauty will sooner transform honesty from what it is to a bawd than the force of honesty will translate beauty into his likeness. This was sometime a paradox, but now the time gives it proof. I did love you once.
Indeed, my lord, you made me believe so.
You should not have believed me, for virtue cannot so inoculate our old stock, but we shall relish of it. I loved you not.
I was the more deceived.
a nunnery. Why, wouldst thou be a breeder of sinners? I am myself indifferent, honest, but yet I could accuse me of such things that it were better my mother had not borne me. I am proud, revengeful, ambitious, with more offenses at my beck than I have thoughts to count them in, imagination to give them shape or time to act them in. What should such fellows as I do crawling between earth and heaven? We are errant knaves all, believe none of us. Go thy ways to a nunnery. Where's your father?
At home, my lord.
Let the doors be shut upon him, that he may play the fool nowhere but in his own house. Farewell.
Oh, welcome, you sweet heaven.
If thou dost marry, I'll give thee this plight for thy dowry. Be thou as chaste as ice, as pure as snow, thou shalt not escape calumny.
Farewell.
Sir, if thou wilt needs marry, marry a fool, for wise men know well enough what monsters you make of them. To a nunnery go, and quickly to farewell.
Heavenly powers restore.
Aye, I have your faces well enough. God hath given you one face, and you make yourselves another. You jing, and amble, and you lisp. You nickname God's creatures, and make your wantonness your ignorance go to. On the morning does that make me mad. I say, we will have no more marriage. Those that are married already, all but one shall live. The rest shall keep as they are. To a nunnery, go.
Oh, what a noble mind is here o'erthrown. The courtiers, scholars, soldiers, eye, tongue, sword, the expectancy and the rose of the fair state. The glass of fashion and the mold of form, the observed of all observers, quite down. And I, of ladies, most deject and wretched, that sucked the honey of his music vows, now see that noble and most sovereign reason like sweet bells jangled out of tune and heart. That unmatched form and feature of blown youth blasted with ecstasy. Oh, woe is me to have seen what I have seen. See what I see.
Love! His affections did not that way tend, nor what he spake, though it lacked form a little, was not like madness. There's something in his soul o'er which his melancholy sits unbrewed, and I do doubt the hatch and the disclosed will be of some danger, which, for to prevent, I have inquicted to him termination, this set it down. He shall with speed to England. Haply, the seas and countries different with variable objects shall expel this something settled matter in his heart, whereon his brains still beating puts him thus from fashion of himself. What think you, aunt?
It shall do well. But yet I do believe the origin and commencement of his grief hath sprung from neglected love. How now, Ophelia? You need not tell us what the Lord Hamlet said. We heard it all. My lord, do as you see fit. But after the play, let his queen mother all alone entreat him to show his grief. Let her be round with him. And I'll be placed, so please you, in the ear of all their conference. If she find him not, to England send him, or confine him where your wisdom best shall think.
It shall be so. Madness and great ones must not unwatched go.
Give it smoothness. Oh, it offends me to the very soul to hear a robust
posthumous fellow tear passion to tatters, to bury rags, to split the ears of the groundlings. I would have such a fellow whipped. Pray avoid it.
I warrant your honor.
Be not too tame neither, but let your own discretion be your tutor. Suit the action to the word to the action, with the special observance that you o'erstep not the modesty of nature. For something so o'erdone is from the purpose of play, whose end both at the first end now was as it and is as twere to hold the mirror up to nature. Oh, there be players that I've seen play and heard others praise, and that highly have so strutted and bellowed that I thought some of nature's journeymen had made them and not made them well, for they imitated humanity so abominably.
I hope we can reform that indifferently with us.
Oh, reform it altogether. And let those that play your clowns speak no more than is set down for them. For there be some of them that will themselves laugh to set on some quantity of barren spectators to laugh too, though in the meantime some necessary question of the play be then to be considered. That's villainous, and shows the most pitiful ambition in the fool that uses it. Go make you ready. How now, my lord? Will the king hear this piece of work?
And the queen too in that presence.
Did the players make haste? Will you two help hasten them?
Aye, my lord.
What ho, Horatio!
Here, sweet lord, at your service.
Horatio, thou art e'en as just a man as e'er my conversation coped with all.
My dear lord.
Nay, do not think I flatter. Give me that man that is not passion's slave, and I will wear him in my heart's core, aye, in my heart of heart, as I do thee. Something too much of this. There's a play tonight before the king. One scene of it comes near the circumstance which I have told thee of my father's death. I prithee, when thou seest that act afoot, even with the very comment of thy soul, observe mine uncle. If his occulted guilt do not itself unkennel in one speech, it is a damned ghost that we have seen. Give him heedful note that I mine eyes will rivet to his face, and after we will both our judgments join in censure of his seeming.
Well, my lord.
Please play.
They're coming to play. I must be idle. Get your place.
Affairs, our cousin Hamlet.
Excellent fay of the chameleon's dish. I eat the air, promised crammed. You cannot be capin' so.
I have nothing with this answer, Hamlet. These words are not mine.
No, nor mine now. Go, my lord. You played me a diversity once, you say.
That I did, my lord, and with accounted a good actor.
What did you enact?
I did enact Julius Caesar. I was killed in the Capitol. Brutus killed me.
It was a brute part of him to kill so capital a cat there. Be the players ready.
Aye, my lord. They stay upon your patience.
Come hither, my dear Hamlet. Sit by me.
No, good mother. Here's metal more attractive.
Oh, do you mark that?
Lady, shall I lie in your lap?
No, my lord.
I mean my head in your lap.
Aye, my lord.
Do you think I meant country matters?
I think nothing, my lord.
That's a fair thought to lie between maids' legs.
What is, my lord?
No thing.
You are merry, my lord.
Who, I?
I, my lord.
Oh, God, you're only jig maker. What should a man do but be merry? For look you how cheerfully my mother looks, and my father died within 2 hours.
Nay, 'tis twice 2 months, my lord.
So long. Nay, then, let the devil wear black for all of a suit of sables. Oh, heavens, die 2 months ago and not forgotten yet. Well, then there's hope a great man's memory may outlive his life half a year.
to me give food, nor heaven light. Sport and repose lock from me day and night. Both here and hence give me lasting strife. If once a widow, ever I be a wife.
If she should break it now.
What means this, my lord?
Marry, it means mischief.
'Tis deeply sworn, but sweet, leave me here a while. My spirits grow dull, and fain I would beguile the tedious day with sleep.
Sleep rock thy brain, and never come mischance between us twain.
Madam, I'll like you this play.
The lady doth protest too much, methinks.
Oh, but she'll keep her word.
Have you heard the argument? Is there no offense in it?
No, no. They do but just poison and just no offense in the world.
What do they call the play?
The Mousetrap. Mary, how tropically.
The play is an image of a murder done in Vienna. Gonzaga is the duke's name, his wife Baptista. You shall see anon, 'tis a knavish piece of work, but what of that? Your majesty and we that have free souls, it touches us not. Let the gully jay wince, our rithers are unwrung. This is one Lucianus, nephew to the king.
You are as good as a chorus, my lord.
I could interpret between you and your love if I could see the puppets dallying.
You are keen, my lord, you are keen.
It would cost you a groaning to take off my edge.
Still better and worse.
So you mistake your husband's. Begin, murderer! Leave thy damnable faces and begin. Come, the croaking raven doth bellow for revenge.
Poisons him in the garden for his estate. His name's Gonzago. You shall see an honor the murder against the love of Gonzago's wife!
The king rises!
What? Frightened with false fire?
Get up there, my lord!
Give her the light!
Give me some light!
Light! Light!
Give me some light! Away! Away!
I did very well note him.
Come, some music. Come, the recorders. Oh. For if the king like not the comedy, why then, like he likes it not. For thee.
Give me a word with you.
Sir, a whole history.
The king, sir.
Aye, sir, what of him?
Is in his retirement marvelous distempered.
With drink, sir?
No, my lord, with choler.
Your wisdom should show itself more richer to signify this to the doctor. For me to put him to his purgation would perhaps plunge him into more choler.
Nay, my lord, put your discourse into some frame and start not so wildly from my affair.
I am tame, sir. Pronouns.
The queen, your mother, in most great affliction of spirit, hath sent me to you.
You are welcome.
Nay, my lord, this courtesy is not of the right breed. If it shall please you to make me a wholesome answer, then I will do the queen's commandment. If not, your pardon and my return will be the end of my business.
Sir, I cannot.
What, my lord?
Make you a wholesome answer. My wit's diseased. But, sir, such answer as I can make you shall command, or rather, as you say, my mother. Therefore, no more but to the point. My mother, you say.
Then doth she says. Your behavior had struck her to amazement. Ooh. And admiration.
Ah, yeah, wonderful son that can so astonish a mother. But is there no sequel at the heels of this mother's admiration? Impart.
She desires to speak to you in her closet, ere you go to bed.
We shall speak with her were she 10 times our mother. Have you any further trade with us?
My lord, you once did love me.
And still do by these pickers.
and stealers.
Good, my lord. What is the cause of your distemper? You do surely bar the door upon your own liberty if you deny your griefs to your friends.
Sir, I lack advancement.
How can that be? When you have the voice of the king himself for your succession in Denmark.
Aye, sir. But while the grass grows, the proverb is something musty. Come, the recorder, let me see it. To withdraw with you, why do you go about to recover the wind of me, as if you would drive me into a trap?
Oh, my lord, if our duty be too bold, my love is too unmannerly.
I do not well understand that. Will you play upon this pipe?
My lord, I cannot.
I pray you.
Believe me, I cannot.
I do beseech you.
I know no touch of it, my lord.
It's as easy as lying. Govern the ventages with your fingers and thumb. Give it a breath with your mouth, and it will discourse most eloquent music. Look you, these are the stops.
But these cannot I command to any utterance of harmony. I have not the skill.
Why, look you now. How unworthy a thing you make of me. You would play upon me. You would seem to know my stops. You would pluck out the heart of my mystery. You would sound me from my lowest note to the top of my compass. And there is much music, excellent voice in this little organ, yet you cannot make it speak. Sir Blood, do you think I am easier to be played upon than a pipe? Call me what instrument you will, though you fret me, you cannot play upon me. God bless you, sir.
My lord, the queen would speak with you in presently.
Do you see under cloud that's almost in the shape of a camel?
Oh, and by the mass, and 'tis like a camel indeed.
Or like a weasel.
It is backed like a weasel.
Or like a whale.
Very like a whale.
But I will come by and by. They fool me to the top of my bent.
I will come by and by.
I will say so.
By and by is easily said. Leave me, friends. Is now the very witching time of night, when churchyards yawn and hell-self breathes out contagion to this world. Now could I drink hot blood and do such bitter business as the day would quake to look on. Soft, now to my mother. O heart, lose not thy nature. I will speak daggers to her, but use none. My tongue and soul in this be hypocrites. How in my words, somever she be shent, to give them seals, never my soul consent.
I like him not. Nor stands it safe with us to let his madness range. Therefore, prepare thyself. I, your commission, will forthwith dispatch, and he to England shall along with you. The terms of our estates may not endure hazard so near us as doth hourly grow out of his brows.
We will ourselves provide. Most holy and religious fear it is to keep those many, many bodies safe that live and feed upon your majesty.
Arm you, I pray you, to this speedy voyage, for we will fetters put about this fear which now goes too free-footed.
We will haste us.
Gentlemen, my lord, he's going to his mother's closet. Behind the arras, I'll convey myself to hear the process. I warrant she'll tax him home. And as you said, wisely was it said, tis meet that some more audience than a mother, since nature makes them partial, should o'erhear the speech advantage. And fare you well, my liege. I'll call upon you ere you go to bed and tell you what I know.
Thanks, dear my lord. Oh, my offense is rank. It smells to heaven. It hath the primal eldest curse upon it. A brother's murder. Pray, can I not, though inclination be sharp as will, my stronger guilt defeats my strong intent, and like a man to double business bound, I stand in pause where I shall first begin and both neglect. What if this cursed hand were more than itself with brother's blood? Is there not rain enough in the sweet heavens to wash away the snow? But whereto saves mercy but to give pardon being down? Then I'll look up. My fault is past, but... Oh, what form of prayer can serve my turn? Forgive me of my foul murder. It cannot be, since I am still possessed of those effects for which I did the murder, my crown, my own ambition, and my queen. May one be pardoned and retain the offense? What then? What rests? Try what repentance can, what can it not? Yet what can it when one cannot repent? Oh, wretched state! Help, angels, make a say! Thou, stubborn knees, and hearts with strings of steel, be as soft as sinews of the newborn babe. All may be well.
Now might I do it, Pat, now he is a prey. And now I'll do it. And so he goes to heaven, and so I am revenged. That would be scanned. A villain kills my father, and for that I, his sole son, do this same villain send to heaven. Why, this is higher in salary, not revenge. He took my father grossly, and how his art stands, who knows save heaven? And am I then revenged to take him in the purging of his soul when he is fit and seasoned for his passage? No! Up, knife! And know thou a more horrid hent when he is drunk asleep, or in his rage, or in the incestuous pleasure of his bed at game of swearing, or about some act that has no relish of salvation in it. Then trip him, that his heels may kick at heaven, and that his soul be as damned and black as hell whereto it goes. Soft my mother stays. This physic but prolongs thy sickly days.
My words fly up, my thoughts remain below. Words without thoughts never to heaven go.
He will come straight. Look you lay home to him. Tell him that his pranks have been too broad to bear with, and that your grace has stood and screened between much heat and him. I'll silence me even here. I pray you be round.
I'll warrant you, fear me not. Withdraw, hear him coming. Now, mother, what's the matter?
Hamlet, thou hast thy father much offended.
Mother, you have my father much offended.
Come, come, you answer with an idle tongue.
Go, go, you question with a wicked tongue.
Why, how now, Hamlet?
What's the matter now?
Have you forgot me?
No, by the rood, not so. You are the queen, your husband's brother's wife. And would it were not so, you are my mother.
Nay, then I'll set those two that can speak.
Come, come, and sit you down. You shall not budge. You go not till I set you up a glass where you may see the inmost part of you.
What wilt thou do? Thou wilt not murder me. Help! Ho!
What ho? Help!
How now? A rat, dead for a ducat, dead! Ah!
Oh, I'm slain!
Oh, me, what hast thou done?
Nay, I know not, this is the king!
What a rash and bloody deed is this?
A bloody deed. Almost as bad, good mother, as kill a king and marry with his brother.
As kill a king?
Aye, lady, was my word. Oh, thou wretched, rash, intruding fool. Oh, I took thee for thy better. Take thy fortune. Thou find'st to be too busy is some danger. Leave wringing of your hands. Peace, sit you down and let me wring your heart, for so I shall if it be made of penetrable stuff.
What have I done that thou darest wag thy tongue and noise so rude against me?
Such an act that blurs the grace and blush of modesty, calls virtue hypocrite, takes off the rose from a fair forehead of an innocent love and sets a blister there, makes marriage vows as false as dicer's oaths. Heaven's face is glow with tristful visage as against the doom is thought sick at the act.
I me, what act that roars so loud and thunders in the index?
Look here upon this picture, and on this, the counterfeit presentment of two brothers. See what a grace was seated on this brow. This was your husband. Look you now what follows. Here is your husband, like a mildewed ear, blasting his wholesome brother. Have you eyes? Could you on this fair mountain leave to feed and batten on this moor? Have you eyes? You cannot call it love, for at your age, the heyday in your blood is tame. It's humble and waits upon the judgment. And what judgment would step from this to this? Oh, shame, where is thy blood? Tell you so!
Speak to me no more. Thou turnst my eyes into my very soul, and there I see such black and grained spots as will leave there their taint.
Nay, but to live in the rank sweat of an enseamed bed, stewed in corruption, honeying and making love over the nasty star.
Speak to me no more. These words like daggers enter in my ears no more. Speak
a murderer and a villain.
No more!
A king of shreds and patches! Save me and hover over me with your wings, you heavenly gods. What would your gracious figure?
Alas, he's mad.
Do you come, your tardy son, to chide? That lapsed in time and passion lets go by the important acting of your dread command. Oh, say.
Do not forget, this visitation is but to wet thy almost blunted purpose. But look, amazement on thy mother sits. Oh, step between her and her biting soul. Conceit in weakest bodies, strongest works. Speak to her, Hamlet.
How is it with you, lady?
Alas, how is it with you that you do bend your eye on vacancy and with incorporeal air do hold discourse? Forth at your eyes your spirits wildly peep, and as the sleeping soldiers in the alarm, your bedded hair like life in excrement start up and stand on end. Gentle sun, upon the heat and flame of thy distemper, sprinkle cool patience. Whereon do you look?
On him, look you how pale he glares. Do not look upon me, lest with this piteous action you convert my stern effects. Then what I have to do will want true color, tears, perchance for blood.
To whom do you speak this?
Do you see nothing there?
Nothing at all, yet all that is I see.
Nor did you nothing here.
No, nothing but ourselves.
Why, look you there, how it steals away my father in his habit as he lived. Look where he goes now,
this,
even out of the portal.
This is the very coinage of your brain. Yeah. This bodiless creation ecstasy is very cunning in.
My pulse, as yours, doth temporally keep time and makes its helpful music. It is not madness that I've uttered.
Mother! For the love of grace, lay not that flattering unction to your soul, that not your trespass, but my madness speaks. Confess yourself to heaven, repent what's past, avoid what is to come, and do not spread the compost on the weeds to make them rancor.
Hamlet, thou hast cleft my heart in twain.
Oh, throw away the worser part of it, and live pure with the other half. Good night. But go not to my uncle's bed. Assume a virtue if you have it not. Refrain tonight, and that shall lend a kind of easiness to the next abstinence, the next more easy. Once again, good night. For this same lord I do repent. But heaven hath pleased it so to punish me with this, and this with me, that I must be their scourge and minister. I will bestow him, and will answer well to the death I gave him. Once again, good night. I must be cruel only to be kind. This bad begins, and worse remains behind.
What shall I do?
Not this. By no means that I bid you do. Let the blow king tempt you again to bed, pinch wanton in your cheek, call you his mouse, and let him for a pair of reachy kisses or paddling in your neck with his damned fingers make you ravel all this matter out that I am essentially not in madness, but mad in craft. 'Twere good you let him know, for who that's but a queen, fair, sober, wise, what from a paddock, a bat, a gib, such dear concernings hide? Who would do so? No, in despite of sense and secrecy, try like the birds to fly and break your own neck down.
Be thou assured, if words be made of breath and breath of life, I have no life to breathe what thou hast said to me.
I must to England, you know that.
Alack, I had forgot. 'Tis so concluded on.
There's letters sealed. And my two schoolfellows, whom I will trust as I will adder's fang, do they bear the mandate? They must sweep my way and marshal me to knavery. Let it work, for 'tis the sport to have the engineer hoist with his own petard, and shall go hard, I will blow them at the bed! Oh, 'tis most sweet when in one line two crafts directly meet. This man shall set me packing. I'll lug the guts into the neighbor room. Mother, good night indeed. This counselor is now most still, most secret, and most grave, who was in life a foolish prating knave. Come, sir, to draw toward and end with you. Good night, mother.
Bestow this place on us a little while. Oh, my own lord, what have I seen tonight?
What? Gertrude, how does Hamlet?
Mad as the wind and sea when both contend which is the mightier. In his lawless fit, behind the air is hearing something stir, whips out his knife, cries, a rat, and in this brainish apprehension kills the unseen good old man.
Oh, heavy deed! It had been so with us had we been there. His liberty is full of threats to all, to you, yourself, to us, to everyone. Alas, how shall this bloody deed be answered? Where is he gone?
To draw apart the body he hath killed, or whom he weeps for what is done.
Oh, Gertrude, come away. The sun no sooner shall the mountains touch, but we will ship him hence. And this vile deed we must, with all our majesty and skill, both countenance and excuse. Ho, Guildenstern! Friends both, go join you with some further aid. Hamlet, in madness, hath Polonius slain, and from his mother's closet hath he dragged him. Go seek him out, speak fair, and bring the body into the chapel.
I pray you make haste in this.
Come, Gertrude. We'll call up our wisest friends and let them know what we mean to do and what's untimely done. So envious slander may miss our name and hit the woundless heir. Oh, come away. My soul is full of discord and dismay.
What have you done, my lord, with the dead body?
Compounded it with dust, whereto it is kin.
Tell us where it is, that we may take it thence and bear it to the chapel.
Do not believe it.
Believe what?
That I can keep your counsel and not mine own. Besides, to be demanded of a sponge. What replication should be made by the son of a king?
Take you me for a sponge, my lord?
Aye, sir, that soaks up the king's countenance, his rewards, his authorities. But such officers do the king best service in the end. When he needs what you have gleaned, it is but squeezing you. And sponge, you shall be dry again.
I understand you not, my lord.
I am glad of it. A knavish speech sleeps in a foolish ear.
My lord, you must tell us where the body is and go with us to the king.
The body is with the king, but the king is not with the body. The king is a thing.
A thing, my lord.
Of nothing. Bring me to him.
How now? What hath befallen?
Where the dead body is bestowed, my lord, you cannot get from him.
Now, Hamlet, where is Polonius?
At supper.
At supper?
Not
where?
Not where he eats, but where he is eaten. A certain convocation of politic worms are in at him. That's the end.
Alas, alas. Where is Polonius?
In heaven. Send thither to see. But if indeed your messenger finds him not there, seek him in the other place yourself. But if indeed you find him not within this month, you shall nose him as you go up the stairs into the lobby.
Go seek him there!
He will stay till you come.
Hamlet! This deed for thine especial safety, which we do tender, as we dearly grieve for that which thou hast done, must send thee hence with fiery quickness. Therefore, prepare thyself. The bark is ready, and everything is bent for England.
For England!
Aye, Hamlet.
Good!
So it is, if thou knewest our purposes.
I see a cherub that sees them. But come, for England. Farewell, dear mother.
Thy loving father, Hamlet.
My mother. Father and mother is man and wife. Man and wife is one flesh. So, my mother. Come for England.
Follow him at foot. Tempt him with speed aboard. Delay it not. I'll have him hence tonight. Away. For everything is sealed and done that else leans on the affair. Pray you make haste. And England. If my love thou holds at aught, thou mayest not coldly set our sovereign process, which imports at full, by letters congruing to that effect, the present death of Hamlet. Do it, England, for like the hectic in my blood he rages, and thou must cure me, till I know 'tis done, howe'er my haps, my joys were ne'er begun. She is importunate, indeed distract. Her moods will need be pitied.
What would she have?
'Twere good she were spoken with, for she may strew dangerous conjectures in ill-breeding minds.
Let her come. To my sick soul, as sin's true nature is, each toy seems prolonged to some great amiss. So full of artless jealousy is guilt, it spills itself in fearing to be spilt. How now, Ophelia?
How should I your true love know from another one? By his cockle hat and staff and his sandal shod.
Alas, sweet lady, what imports this song?
Say you. Nay, pray you mark. He is dead and gone, lady. He is dead and gone.
deceit upon her father.
Let's have no words of this, but when they ask you what it means, say, hear this. Tomorrow is St. Valentine's Day, and in the morning betime, and I, a maid at your window, to be your valentine. Then up he rose and donned his clothes and ducked the chamber door. Let in the maid, let out a maid. Never departed more.
Pretty Ophelia.
Indeed, without an oath, I'll make an end on it. By Jesus and by charity, alack and fie for shame. Young men will do it if they come to it, but God, they are to blame. Quoth she, before you tumble me, you promised me to wed. Yes, so what I done by yonder sun, if thou hadst not come to my bed.
How long has she been thus?
I hope all will be well. We must be patient. But I could not choose one week to think that they would lay him in the cold ground. My brother shall know of it. And so I thank you for your good counsel. Come, my coach. Good night, sweet ladies. Good night.
Good night. Good night. Good night.
Give her good watch, I pray you. Oh, this is the poison of deep grief. Springs from her father's death. And now behold, ooh, Gertrude, Gertrude, when sorrows come, they come not single spies, but in battalions. The people, moneyed, thick and unwholesome in their thoughts and whispers for good Polonius's death. We have done but greenly and hugger-mugger to inter him. Poor Ophelia divided from herself in her fair judgment. Her brother is in secret come from France. Attend! Where are my soldiers? Let them bar the door! What is the matter?
Save yourself, my lord! Young Laertes in a riot's head overbears your officers.
The rabble call him lord.
They cry, choose we! Laertes shall be king! Laertes shall be king! Laertes king!
How cheerfully on the false trail they cry! Oh, this is counter, you false Danish dogs!
The doors are broke!
Calmly, good Laertes.
That drop of blood that's calm proclaims me master.
What is the cause, good Laertes, that thy rebellion looks so giant-like? Let him go, Gertrude. Do not fear our person. Tell me, Laertes, why thou art thus incensed. Let him go, Gertrude. Speak, man.
Where is my father?
Dead.
But not by him.
Let him demand his fill.
How came he dead? I'll not be juggled with to hell, allegiance. Avenged most thoroughly for my father.
Good Laertes, if you desire to know the certainty of your dear father, is it writs in your revenge that swoopstake you will draw both friend and foe, winner and loser?
None but his enemies.
Will you know them then?
To his good friends, thus wide I'll open my arms.
Why, now you speak like a good child and a true gentleman. I am guiltless of your father's death, and am most sensibly in grief for it. Let her come in.
How now, what noise is that? Dear maid. Kind sister. Sweet Ophelia. Oh, heavens. Is it possible a young maid's wits should be as mortal as an old man's life.
They bore him there, based on the bier, and in his grave ran many a tear. Fare you well, my dove. It is the false steward that stole his master's daughter.
This nothing's more than matter.
Rosemary, that's for remembrance. Pray you love
remember.
Document in madness. Thoughts and remembrance fitted.
There's fennel and columbines. There's rue for you. And some for me. You must wear your rue with a difference.
There's a daisy. I would give you violets, but they withered all when my father died. They say he made a good end. And will he not come again? And will he not come again? No, no.
Patience to us, and we will jointly labor with your soul to give it due content.
Let this be so. His means of death, his obscure funeral, no noble rite nor formal ostentation, cry to be heard, as were from heaven to earth, that I must cult in question.
So you shall. And where the offense is, let the great axe fall. I pray you, go with me.
There is a letter for you, sir. It came from the ambassador that was bound for England.
Horatio, let the king have the letters I have sent, and repair thou to me with as much speed as thou wouldest fly death. I have words to speak in thine ear will make thee dumb, yet are they much too light for the bore of the matter. Rosencrantz and Guildenstern hold their course for England. Of them I have much to tell thee. Farewell. He that thou knowest thine, Hamlet. Come. Convey these letters to the king. Do it, the speedier.
Yes?
This to your majesty and this to the queen.
From Hamlet? Who brought them?
Sailors, my lord. They say I saw them not.
Laertes, you shall hear them. Leave us. High and mighty, you shall know I am set naked on your kingdom. Tomorrow shall I beg leave to see your kingly eyes, when I shall, first asking your pardon, thereunto recount the occasion of my strange and more sudden return. What should this mean? Are all the rest come back, or is it no such thing and just some abuse?
Know you the hand?
'Tis Hamlet's character. And in a postscript here, he says, alone. Can you devise me?
I am lost in it, my lord. But let him come. It warms the very sickness in my heart that I shall live and tell him to his teeth, thus diest thou.
If it be so, Laertes, as thou should it be so, thou otherwise. Will you be ruled by me?
Aye, my lord, so you will not overrule me to a peace.
To thine own peace. If he be now returned, I'll work him to an exploit. Now ripen my device, under the which he shall not choose but fall. And for his death, no wind of blame shall breathe, but even his mother shall uncharge the practice and call it accident.
My lord, I will be ruled.
Was your father dear to you, Laertes?
Why ask you this?
What would you undertake to show yourself indeed your father's son, more than in words?
To cut his throat in the church.
No place indeed should murder sanctuarize. Revenge should have no bounds. But, good Laertes, Hamlet returned shall know you are come home. Will hire those, shall praise your excellence in art and exercise at sword display, and thus for sport bring you with him together and wager over your heads. He, being remiss, most generous and free from all contriving, will not peruse the foils, so that with ease, or with a little shuffling, you may choose a sword unabated, and in a passive practice requite him for your father.
I will do it, and for that purpose I'll anoint my sword. I bought an unction of a mountebank so mortal that but dip a knife in it where it draws blood. No cataplasm so rare can save the thing from death that is but scratched withal. I'll touch my point with this contagion that if I gall him slightly, it may be death.
Let's further think on this. This project should have a back or a second if this did blast and proof. Soft, let me see. We'll make a solemn wager o'er your cunnings. I have it. When in your motion you are hot and dry, as thus make your bouts more violent to that end, and then he calls for drink, I'll have prepared for him a chalice for the nuts, whereon but sipping, if he by chance escape your venom stuck, our purposes may hold there. But stay, what noise?
One woe doth tread upon another's heel so fast they follow. Your sister's drowned, Laertes.
Drowned? Oh, where?
There is a willow, grows askant the brook, that shows his hoary leaves in the glassy stream. There with fantastic garlands did she make of crow flowers, nettles, daisies, and long purples that liberal shepherds give a grosser name but our cold maids do dead man's fingers call them. There on the pendant boughs her crow net weeds clamoring to hang an envious sliver broke, went down her weedy trophies and herself fell in the weeping brook. Her clothes spread wide and mermaid like a while they bore her up, which time she chanted snatches of old lods, as one incapable of her own distress, or like a creature native and undued unto that element. But long it could not be till her garments, heavy with their drink, pulled the poor wretch from her melodious lay to bloody dead.
Alas, then she is drowned.
Drowned.
Too much of water hast thou, poor Ophelia, and therefore I forbid my tears. But yet it is our trick. Nature her custom holds. Let shame say what it will! When these are gone, the woman will be out. Adieu, my lord. I have a speech of fire that fain would blaze, but that this folly doubts it.
Come, Gertrude, let's follow. So much I had to do to calm his rage. Now, I fear this will give a start again. Therefore, let's follow.
sir.
I think it be thine indeed, for thou liest in it.
You lie out on, sir, and therefore it is not yours. For my part, I do not lie in it yet. It is mine.
Thou dost lie in it, to be in it and say 'tis thine. 'Tis for the dead, not for the quick. Therefore thou liest.
'Tis a quick lie, sir. It will away again from me to you.
What man dost thou dig for?
For no man, sir.
What woman, then?
None, neither.
Who is to be great buried in it?
One that was a woman, sir, but rest her soul, she's dead.
How absolute the knave is. How long hast thou been grave maker?
Of all the days of the year, I came to it that very day that young Hamlet was born. He that is mad and sent into England.
Aye, Mary. Why was he sent into England?
Why? Because he was mad. He shall recover his wits there, or if he do not, it is no great matter there.
Why?
'Twill not be seen in him there. There are men are mad as he.
How came he mad?
Very strangely, they say.
How strangely?
Faith, e'en with losing his wits.
Upon what ground?
Why, here in Denmark?
How long will a man lie in the earth ere he rot?
Faith, if he be not rotten before he die, he will last you some 8 year or 9 year. A tanner will give you 9 year.
Why he more than another?
Why, sir, his hide is so tanned with strait that he will keep out water a great while. And your water is a sore decayer of your horse and dead body. Mm-hmm. Now, here's a skull that lying in the earth 23 year.
Whose was it?
A horse, a mad fellow it was. Who do you think it was?
Nay, I know not.
A pestilence on him for a mad rogue. He poured a flagon of reddish on my head once. This same skull, sir, was Yorick's skull, the king's jester.
This?
In that.
Poor Yorick. I knew him, Horatio, a fellow of infinite jest, of most excellent fancy. He hath bore me on his back 1,000 times, and now, how abhorred in my imagination it seems, my gorge rises at it. Here hung those lips I have kissed I know not how oft. Where be your gibes now, your gambols, your songs, your flashes of merriment that were wont to set the table on a roar? Not when now to mock your own grinning. Quite chop-fallen. Now get you to my lady's chamber, and you tell her, let her paint an inch thick, to this favor she must come. Make her laugh at that. Prithee, Horatio, tell me one thing.
What's that, my lord?
Dost thou think Alexander looked to this fashion in the earth?
E'en so.
And smelt so.
E'en so, my lord.
To what base uses we may return, Horatio?
'Twere to consider too curiously to consider so.
No, faith, not a jot. Alexander died. Alexander was buried. Alexander returneth to the dust. The dust is earth. Of earth we make loam, and why, if that loam were to he was converted, might they not stop a beer barrel? Soft a while. Here comes the king, the queen, the courtiers. Who is this they follow, and with such maimed rites? This doth betoken the corpse they follow did with desperate hand fordo its own life. 'Twas of some estate, couch me a while and mark.
Obsequies have been as far enlarged as we have warranted. Her death was doubtful.
Must there no more be done?
No more be done.
Lay her in the earth, and from her fair and unpolluted flesh may violet spring. I tell thee, churlish priest, a ministering angel shall my sister be when thou liest howling.
What, the fair Ophelia? Speak to the sweet. I hope thou shouldst have been my Hamlet's wife. I thought
thought thy bride bed to have decked sweet maid and not have strewed thy grave.
Hold off the earth a while, till I've got it once more in my arms.
What is he whose grief bears such an emphasis, whose phrase of sorrow conjures the wandering stars and makes them stand like wander-wounded hearers? This is how I am at the day.
The devil take thy soul!
I pray it's not well. I pray thee, take thy fingers from my throat. For though I'm not speculative and rash, yet have I in me something dangerous which let thy wiseness hear. Hold up thy hand!
Oh, put them asunder!
Gentlemen!
My lord, be quiet.
Why? I will fight with him upon his theme until my eyelids no longer weigh.
Poor son, what theme?
I loved Ophelia. 14 brothers with all their quantity of love cannot make up my sum. What wilt thou do for her?
Oh, he is mad, Laertes.
For love of God, forbear him. So show me what thou do. Dost come here to whine, to outface me with leaping in her grave. Be buried quick with her, and so will I. And if thou prate of mountains, let them throw millions of acres on us. Nay, I'll rat as well as thou.
This is mere madness, and thus a while the fit will work on him.
Hear you, sir. What is the reason you used me thus? I loved you ever. But it is no matter. Let Hercules himself do what he may. The cat will mew, and dog will have his day.
I pray thee, good Horatio, if upon him, strengthen your patience in our last night's speech. We'll put the matter to the present push. Good Gertrude, set some watch over your son. This grave shall have a living monument. An hour of quiet thereby shall we see. Till then, patience our proceedings be.
So much for this, sir. Now shall you see the other.
Yes, my lord, aboard ship with your two schoolfellows.
Up from my cabin, in the dark, groped I to find out them. Had my desire, fingered their packet, making so bold to unseal their grand commission, where I found Horatio, royal knavery, on exact command my head should be struck off.
Is it possible?
Here's the commission, read it at more leisure. And wilt thou now hear how I did proceed?
I beseech you.
I sat me down, devised a new commission, wrote it fair on honest conjuration from the king. He should those bearers, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, put to sudden death.
But how was the seal?
Why, even in that was heaven ordinant. I had my father's signet in my purse, which was the model of that Danish seal. Folded the writ in form of the other, subscribed it, gave the impression, placed it safely, the changeling never known. Now the next day was our sea flight, and what to this was sequent thou knowest already.
So Guildenstern and Rosencrantz go to it.
Why, man, they did make love to this employment.
What a king is this?
Does it not think thee stand me now upon? He that hath killed my king and whored my mother, popped on between election and my hopes, thrown out his angle for my proper life and with such cousinage. Is it not perfect conscience to quit him with this arm? And is it not to be damned to let this canker of our nature come in further evil?
Peace. Who comes here?
Your lordship is right welcome back to Denmark. I humbly thank you, madam. Dost know this waterfly?
No, my good lord.
Sweet lord, if your lordship were at leisure, I should impart a thing to you from his majesty.
I will receive it with all diligence of spirit. Your bonnet to his right use, 'tis for the head.
I thank your lordship, it is very hot.
No, believe me, 'tis very cold. The wind is northerly.
It is indifferent cold, my lord, indeed.
But yet to me thinks it's very sultry and hot for my complexion.
Exceedingly, my lord, it is very sultry, as 'twere. I cannot tell how. His majesty bade me signify to you that he has laid a wager upon your head. This is the matter—
I beseech you, remember.
Nay, good my lord, my ease, in good faith. Here has newly come to court Laertes, and believe me, an absolute gentleman, full of most excellent differences, a very soft society, and great showing.
Madam, I take him to be a soul of great article.
You are not ignorant of what excellence Laertes is?
I dare not confess that, lest I should compare with him in excellence. But to know a man well were to know himself.
I mean, sir, for his weapon, but in the imputation laid on him by them in his meed, he's unfellowed.
What's his weapon?
Rapier and dagger.
That's two of his weapons. Well,
the king, sir, hath laid, sir, that in 12 hits between yourself and him, he shall not exceed you 3 hits. He hath laid a 12 for 9, and it would come to immediate trial if your lordship would vouchsafe the answer.
How if I answer no?
I mean, sir, the opposition of your person in trial.
Let the foils be brought, the gentleman willing, and the king hold his purpose. I will win for him, and I can. If not, I will gain nothing but my shame and the odd hit.
Shall I deliver you so?
To this effect, madam, after what flourish your nature will.
I will commend my duty to your lordship.
Yours. She does well to commend it herself. There are no tongues else for her turn.
My lord, you will lose.
I do not think so. Since he went into France, I have been in continual practice. I shall win at the odds. Thou wouldst not think how ill all's here about my heart, but it is no matter.
Nay, good lord.
It is but foolery, but it is such a kind of gain-giving that would perhaps trouble a woman.
If your mind is like anything, obey it. I will forestall repair there hither and say you are not fit.
Not a whit. We defy augury. There's special providence in the fall of a sparrow. If it be now, 'tis not to come. If it be not to come, it will be now. If it be not now, yet it will come. The readiness is all. Since no man of aught he leaves knows aught, what is it to leave betimes? Let me. What I have done, I here proclaim, was madness. Was it Hamlet wronged, Laertes? Never Hamlet. Who does it then? His madness. If it be so, his madness is poor Hamlet's enemy. Sir, in this audience, let my disclaiming from a purposed evil free me so far in your most generous thoughts that I shot the arrow o'er my house and hurt my brother. I am satisfied in nature whose motive in this case should stir me most to my revenge. But in my terms of honor, I stand aloof and will no reconcilement till by some elder masters of known honor I have a voice and precedent of peace to keep my name ungored. But till that time, I do receive your offered love, like love, and will not wrong it.
I embrace it freely. And will this brother's wager frankly play? Give us the foil.
Come, one for me. All be your foil, Laertes. In mine ignorance, your skill shall like a star in the darkest night stick fiery off indeed.
You mock me, sir.
No, by this hand.
Give them the foils, young Osric. Cousin Hamlet, you know the wager.
Very well, my lord. Your grace has laid the odds on the weaker side.
I do not fear it. I have seen you both, but since he is bettered, we have therefore odds.
This is too heavy. Let me see another. This likes me well. These foils have all a length.
Aye, my lord.
Set me the stoup of wine upon that table. If Hamlet give the first or second hit, or quit in exchange the third, let all the battlements their ordinance fire. The king shall drink to Hamlet's better breath, and in a cup an union shall he throw, richer than that which 4 successive kings of Denmark have borne. Come, give me the cup. And let the kettle to the trumpet speak, the trumpet to the cannoneer without, the cannon to the heavens, the heaven to earth. Now the king drinks to Hamlet. Come, begin. And you, the judges, bear a wary eye.
Come on, sir.
Come, my lord.
Oh.
Very palpable hit.
Well, again.
Stay! Give me drink. Hamlet, this pearl is thine. Here's to thy health. Come, give him the cup.
I'll play this bout first. Set it by a while. Come. Another hit, what say you?
I do confess.
Our son shall win.
You fat and scant of breath. Dear Hamlet, take my napkin, rub thy brows. The queen carouses to thy fortune, Hamlet.
Good madam.
Oh, Gertrude, do not drink.
I will, my lord. I pray you pardon me.
It is the poison cup, it is too late.
I dare not drink it, madam, by and by. Come, let me wipe my face.
My lord, I'll hit him now.
I do not think it.
And yet it is almost against my conscience.
Come for the third, Laertes, you do but dally. I pray you pass with your best violence. I'm afeard you make a wanton of me.
Say you so. Come on.
Nothing in neither way.
How about you now?
Part them, you're incensed.
Nay, come again.
Look to the queen there! Oh, they bleed on both sides! How is it, my lord?
How is it, Laertes?
Why, as a wit caught to mine own spring, Osric, I'm justly killed with my own treachery.
How does the queen?
Oh, she swoons to see the bleed!
No, the drink, my dear Hamlet, the drink! I'm poisoned!
Oh, villainy! Oh! Let the doors be locked! Treachery! Seek it out!
It is here!
Hamlet! Hamlet, thou art slain! No medicine in the world can do thee good. In thee, there was not half an hour's life. The treacherous instrument is in thy hand, unbated and envenomed. The foul practice hath turned itself on me. Lo, here I lie, never to rise again. Thy mother's poison. I can no more.
The king's to blame. The poison venom too. The venom to thy work.
Treason! Treason! Defend me, friend. I am but hurt.
Here, thou incestuous murderous damned dame. Drink off this potion. Is thy union here? Follow my mother. He is justly served. It is a poison tempered by himself.
Exchange forgiveness with me, noble Hamlet. Mine and my father's death come not upon thee, nor thine on me. Heaven make thee free of it. I follow thee. I am dead, Horatio. Wretched queen, adieu.
You that look pale and tremble at this chance, had I but time.
This fell sergeant death is strict in his rust. Oh, I could tell you, but let it be. Horatio, I am dead. Thou livest, report me and my cause aright to the unsatisfied.
Never believe it. I'm more an antique Roman than a Dane. Here's yet some liquor left.
Dost thou or to man give me the cup? Let's go, by heaven, I'll hat. If thou didst ever hold me in thy heart, absent thee from felicity a while. And in this harsh world draw thy breath in pain to tell my story. Hear my dying voice, and tell my story with the occurrence more or less which I've solicited. The rest is silence.
now grants a noble heart. Good night, sweet prince. Flights of angels sing thee to thy rest.
What is it you would see? If thought of woe or wonder?
Cease your search, and let me speak to thy yet unknowing world how these things came to be. So shall you hear of carnal, bloody, and unnatural acts of accidental judgment, of casual slaughters, of deaths put on by cunning and forced cause. And in this upshot, purposes mistook and fallen on the inventor's heads. All this I can truly deliver.
So that those of you who have to leave can leave, and those of you who would like to stay and participate in our talk back will begin in just a couple of minutes. Thank you. I just want to say before we start, for any of you folks out there in TV land, the high schools that are watching, I have my phone, and my partner is watching at home and taking all of your questions as well. So any question that you have, she will text to me, and I will ask it here, and they will answer it there.
Is that technology? Can I say hi?
That is still
hi, on. Jenny! I love you!
Hi, Mom!
Hi, Margaret!
Hi, Mom and Dad!
Okay. All right, you done the highs?
Yeah.
Hi! I think we should probably start just by introducing everybody. So why don't we start at the end with the wizard that put this together.
Hi, I'm Jeanette Lambert-Mori, and I directed this.
Yeah!
My name is Santiago Guzman, and I'm an actor.
My name is Tyler Matthews, and I was also
Horatio.
Yeah.
I'm Michaela, I was Hamlet.
I'm Brooke Adams, and I played Laertes.
I'm Sarah Connors, and I played Ophelia.
I'm Christian Morgan, I played Rosencrantz, and I also fight choreographed this.
I'm Bella Rakowski, and I'm Gertrude.
I'm Shailen Barnes, and I played Guildenstern.
I'm Matt Ralph, and I played the Ghost and the Gravedigger.
I'm Devin Bryan, and I played Polonius.
I'm Austin Card, and I played Marcellus, the priest, and the guy with the crown.
And I was audience. Do we have any technicians up there?
Yeah, I got us.
Come on down. There might be some technicality type questions as well. So come on down, introduce yourself. Sheldon?
I'm Sheldon, I was a stage writer for this.
And Brandon?
Brandon Boyne, I was a lighting operator.
And Alexandra's up there, she's our sound op. And assistant sound designer.
Yeah, girl! Yeah.
Great, so I can kind of moderate things. Maybe I'll go back here so the camera can see me.
It's all about
All right, I guess we'll just open it up and anybody have any observations, questions, comments that they'd like to make? Nothing. Thank you.
It's like seeing us.
How many?
Our lungs are just so full.
I know it's hard to comment, isn't it? How many of you have seen? How many of you have? How many of you studied Hamlet in school?
Yeah.
How many of you in TV land studied Hamlet in school?
Are they gonna raise their hands?
Probably all of you. Well, why don't we start with you guys making some comments? Do you have any, Michaela? Let's start with you. The obvious question is, what's it like to play Hamlet?
It's crazy.
As a woman.
Oh my goodness, it's wild, and the process has been really, really fun. I'm still like buzzing off of the show. But yeah, I mean, I wish everyone could play Hamlet as well. I wish everyone could experience this journey because he just goes all over the place.
What do you think was, what was the most difficult part of the journey through this character?
The most difficult part of this character was probably tapping into truth, weirdly enough. As an actor, it's easy to play things, to play and not really feel things, especially for To Be or Not To Be, where it's so... When I say To Be or Not To Be, I know people in the audience are probably like, oh, okay, here we go. Another To Be or Not To Be. But it's different when you really tap into it and really think about what that means to you. What is it to be or not to be? Mm-hmm. And his questions are layered in truth with all of us, I think. And that's how you get the real emotion coming out, not just, oh, woe is me.
We have a question from one of our viewers.
Wow.
Yes, we do.
Oh, that's so great.
This comes from a school in Central, and the question is, how do you memorize? Wait. All those seemingly random words.
Oh.
I think it's a pretty interesting question.
That's a really good question.
Actually, yes. So does anybody want to tackle that one and talk about the seemingly random words?
You first understand what they mean.
Table word.
Yeah.
Lots of table words.
They're not random to us.
Seemingly random. I'm not sure sure if I understand.
I do. I understand it. Absolutely. That's because when we've talked about this in rehearsal, that the text is very stream of consciousness. It really mimics real living thought. That doesn't necessarily become apparent when you're just reading it on the page as a piece of literature, but when you're learning it as an actor, you very quickly realize that the combination of the rhythm of the text and the way the thoughts have been laid out on the page is exactly like living thought. You interrupt your own thoughts, you backtrack on something, you divert for a moment on a little sidetrack and then come back to your main point. As soon as an actor catches on to that, it becomes easy because it becomes familiar. And then the lines are just there. It's also, iambic pentameter does help. Mm-hmm. It is easier to memorize when it has that rhythm underneath it because you know when something's missing.
And just for you, those of you out there in TV Land who may not understand what Jeanette means by iambic pentameter, it's the rhythm in which Shakespeare writes, and it goes da-dum, 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 da-dum. And every line is
every
just...
Every verse line
every
has
verse
that.
Line
although hopefully you can't tell.
Yes, every verse line in the piece has that rhythm or something similar to it. And Shakespeare's really quite wonderful because within that rhythm, when that rhythm breaks, when it goes da-dum, 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 to be or not to be, that is the question. You know, and that makes an actor think immediately. And so writing in that rhythm really helps an actor, it gives an actor a whole lot of information. So you know, I understand the seemingly randomness as well, because he does, Hamlet goes, well, he feigns madness.
That's right.
Yeah. So, but the language itself is very full, very rich.
But I took that seemingly random to mean living thought. Like, I took that to mean, wow, it sounds like you're just making it up as you go along.
Mm.
Yeah. So I think that's a great compliment.
Yeah, I think so too.
Yeah.
So thank you for the question.
It also helps to be well-read. I mean, we're required to take a Shakespeare English course. And we also learn Shakespeare in acting, which,
that just doesn't like roll off our tongues the first time.
No. You gotta get a little familiar with it.
Yes.
On our end of things as well, especially if you're a stage manager, if you're a technician, sometimes it's very easy to detach yourself from a show. I'm doing lighting, I'm building the set, I'm doing that, I'm painting the floor. But if you're a stage manager, someone who your main job is to make actors safe and comfortable in their process, let them do their work by you taking up what you can. Being someone who is well-read and knowing the Shakespeare, you don't have to know Shakespeare in the same way as the actors do, of course, but being able to be there with somebody to help them run their lines even, to do some seemingly basic things that help other people get further in their process, mm-hmm. so that when it comes to here, you don't see all the work that came in, but obviously so much has happened for every single person to be able to be on the stage and one, know what they're saying, two, have the friggin' thing memorized, and to say it in such a way that moves someone from that seemingly random mm-hmm. language.
Mm-hmm. Also, it's probably important to note that we've been rehearsing since September.
Yes.
Yeah.
So there's quite a lot of work. In this,
yeah. It's a lot of work. I have another question. And this one is how difficult was it to play different genders?
Juicy.
Hamlet's usually played by a guy.
Just so y'all know.
So is Laertes.
And Guildenstern.
And Guildenstern. Mm-hmm. And, no, Gertrude's always right. So what was that like, guys? What was that, what was it, girls?
Quite easy, actually. I'm being honest here. Like, you know, with any character, whether it's a male or female, they're going to have their mannerisms. And that's not necessarily outright, like, male or female, like, walking like this makes me a male. No, like, we all walk different ways, whether we're man or woman. And Hamlet just emerged from experimenting and playing with the text as well. And, we all feel emotions. We're all human.
Like when I got this role and I read the script, I never told myself I'm gonna play a man. I'm playing a man. I didn't approach it like that. I what came, the man that came out of Laertes was from rehearsal, from trying to tell the truth. I used to struggle with my beginning scene with Ophelia because I thought I was coming across as too feminine. But I said, no, I got to speak the truth to her. I care about her. And through that honesty, I found an older brother. And I've even been told that my voice is lower when I'm up here. I don't know where that comes from, but it happens. So, you know, I have never tried to apply something on top of it. Things have just come out of exercises in rehearsal and the text and everyone around you, you know? Like, I love my scenes with, Keelan's not here, Claudius. I love my scenes with Claudius because I feel like I'm on the same level as him. He treats me like one of him, so
yes, absolutely.
It's from all of that together, so it was actually pretty easy. Yeah.
Well, it's with that, we talked earlier too about being a father in a scene when you're not a father, and you don't have to
Say, I'm going to play a father.
Yeah, you don't have to have kids to experience that in a scene.
Yes.
The matter of which.
Yeah. Playing a father was a really, really weird experience for me at first. The first scene where I'm giving Laertes advice before he goes off to France, and it was one of the last scenes that I'd actually found in the rehearsal process, but one of the first that I had started working on. So it did take me quite a while to get there, but it happened.
Any questions from here?
I have a question for the director about the placement of characters on the side. Like, they didn't necessarily have to leave to become some other character or anybody else. They were stationary in the shadows.
Yes.
So I was just curious as to why that was made a decision.
The lives of all those characters are part of the story. That it's not just who's on stage at this moment that's involved in the energy of what's happening on stage. So that's really where that came from. And for them to experience these scenes through their bodies behind them and let that inform the journey to the next scene, for instance. And so that the whole ensemble is, especially at the beginning, the earlier part of the play, the whole ensemble is there evolving into this story, and then as things start to fracture, they start disappearing. Some disappear to the death place, and some disappear backstage. But that was the theory of it.
I was going to say, because having the visual reference, if Hamlet's on stage and you're talking about his mother or the king,
yep.
Having glance over the shadows and seeing them both together.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I'm very glad you saw that.
Yeah.
That was the idea. So,
great.
Okay, for those of you in TV land, that answer was to the question. What was your question again? The benches on either side, and why that? Yeah. So, I've been told I have to repeat the questions because the folks at home
can't
hear the questions coming from the audience.
Yes.
So, anything else from the audience?
Oh,
yes, Ruff.
I have another Jeanette question.
Uh-oh.
this is going to be one of those probably over-asked and kind of contrived questions, but I'm going to ask it anyway.
Sure.
Because I think it's interesting. So, I mean, obviously there are 100 different Hamlets. There's so many different productions, and I mean, I don't know, maybe for people watching who don't have a lot of experience with it, the uncut Hamlet is like 4 hours long. It's almost never done in its entirety because there's just so much to it. So obviously, with every version, there are scenes or parts of scenes taken out.
Yes.
You have little edits, blah, blah, blah. And obviously, your edits are unique to yours. So I guess just, did you have a process in choosing what had to go?
Yes.
And how did you, because we get told so often that, you know, you dive into a piece of work and it's like, okay, nothing's sacred. You can't be too in love with any one bit because otherwise you're never going to be able to let go of anything. So
yeah, I mean, so the question is, how did I make my decisions as far as editing the text? Because it's severely edited. I cut
yes.
a lot because we wanted a reasonable playing time. But I also wanted to get to the core of what interested me in the story right now at this particular time. And It was very much about family, of two family units in the story. So the Claudius Gertrude royal family with Hamlet as the royal son, and of course the Polonius family. So that sort of led me at the beginning. I also knew I was going to remove the political backdrop because it's tricky stuff anyway in the play. It only appears very rarely and sporadically through the play, so it's hard to maintain a through line of that. So it was fairly easy to get rid of that. And also, because I was interested in royalty or modern royalty as celebrity. So I was also, that's where we have this, the crowds and the gate. And so those things helped inform me when I was looking at the page and where I wanted to go and what was going to get cut. We also cut in rehearsal. When we discovered we could get to the core of something a little bit more quickly. But I wasn't just cutting all the beautiful stuff and leaving just the core of the plot either, because the language itself is such an essential, fundamental part of doing this kind of work. So all of those factors played into it.
Mm-hmm. Other questions? I thought there was one.
Yes,
Tom.
One of the things that struck me right after that was the physicality of some of the characters, the rhythm, the movement. And so I'm wondering if maybe the director or Hamlet or Ophelia could talk about the process of discovering the rhythm of the movement.
What Ophelia?
Yeah.
So the question was about the rhythm of the movement of the piece and how the actors have discovered the rhythm and the movement in the piece.
Mm-hmm. I found a lot of movement within the mad scene, especially. I think when I finally was able to tap into that emotion and that overall feeling of just she's lost everything and all that type of stuff, I kind of with it came a loss of balance, kind of, and that's kind of where all my movements were coming from because she's lost everything, kind of including her balance and. She's lost her sanity and all that, and the balance just kind of went with it. So I think that's where my movement really came from with that. But it all stemmed from the emotion and how I, as Ophelia, was feeling it.
We also started the process, not very much, we didn't get a chance to do much, but we did start the process with Louise doing some animal work. So that everyone did begin by thinking about their bodies and what kinds of animals they might have inside them to play these characters.
Yes.
So we didn't really pursue that in any great way, but it did sink in subconsciously, I think. Mm-hmm. Somewhere underneath, they understood that these characters were to be physical as well, and not just walking intellectual heads.
Yes, Leah.
Della, what was your favorite outfit?
Question is, what was your favorite outfit, Della?
My dressing gown.
Yes.
My velvet slippers and silk dressing gown and casual velvet sleeping attire, which is like I stepped out of the royal family.
Yeah.
It's very comfortable. I did not want to put heels back on.
And the blue one.
And, sorry,
and the blue one.
And all of the other ones.
All of them, Renata's fantastic.
Yes, thank you, Renata. Shout out to
Renata. Renata was the costume designer for the show.
Yes.
And Wendy Vay, who built them, I think.
Yes,
yes.
Thank you, Wendy, too.
Yes, Wendy. Anything else? Yes.
Jeanette's been getting all the questions, so I'll throw one over to the actors. Shakespeare's Shakespeare, it's heavy, it's big, and when you guys found out that you were cast in the Shakespeare show for the semester, I know not everybody's like comfortable with Shakespeare, not everybody understands it. How did you guys kind of get through that?
Yeah.
I would argue. So the question was, not everybody is comfortable with Shakespeare, and when they discovered that they'd been cast in the Shakespeare play for this semester, how did they get through that, discomfort with Shakespeare? That
I guess, like,
fear of discomfort with Shakespeare?
Can I pass it to Shaylin too?
Sure, yes.
you too.
Come on, you can put your hand up first, please. I just want to argue.
This is interesting.
I wasn't casted in Shakespeare, and then I was casted in Shakespeare, and I'm a fourth year, so I'm in my final year of my degree, and I was one of the special ones that almost squeaked out without getting in a Shakespeare show, and then I got in a Shakespeare show, and
you should just stop there for a minute and explain this.
Yeah, come on.
Shailene joined us in Q2Q, so she literally stepped in to the role when we were in tech.
Saturday morning.
This
was my fifth run of the show.
Yes.
Like there was no rehearsal. I was like,
yeah.
Welcome to the theater.
Yeah, that's right.
Swim.
But yeah, so I had to get really comfortable really quick, and I was like, thank you, Shailene, for reading Hamlet over the summer and being a keener. And just actually reading for the required readings of English classes, like do it, do it. Okay. Anyway, I became comfortable by my intellect, I guess. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. You don't do your readings in Shakespeare Survey, you're shooting yourself in the foot. But honestly, it's intimidating at first. Like you think it's a wall of text, but it's really not. Mm-hmm. You pick it apart sentence by sentence, and it's just. It looks like maybe flowery language if you're if you have not experienced acting Shakespeare before, but really it is. It's. We keep on saying the word truth tonight, but it's very real. It can be. Shakespeare has written characters who are just very genuine and real and easy to read. It's unbelievable how when we get into rehearsal processes, it's. It's just as quick as a contemporary play. Mm-hmm. The rehearsal is not slower. Like there's a bit more table work, sure.
Yeah.
We have to make sure we understand what we're saying, but once we know what we're saying, it's just like any other play.
Yeah. I panicked. I said to Jeanette, I didn't understand it. I was like, Shakespeare and I aren't friends. I don't understand it at all. And I was paranoid, and we're friends now. But,
on good terms.
But it's really intimidating, and what Christian said, once you understand that it's a real person who has actual emotions, they just express them differently.
Mm-hmm.
It becomes a lot easier to understand what you're saying, what you're thinking, what's going on around you as not a posh person in haha theater on stage, as a real human who has actual questions and issues and emotions. And once you kind of figure that out, it doesn't become Shakespeare, it becomes real people written on paper. Like, that you create into this.
Yeah, I would like to add something to that as well. English is not my first language.
Mm-hmm.
And I came here because I wanted to learn how to Shakespeare. but I was really afraid to do it because I felt it was going to be like a third language for me, which kind of is. but it was really interesting, especially like in the rehearsal process, see my castmates struggle the same way that I struggle with English in general. So it was really interesting, and I really appreciated that part of the process, seeing people struggle the same way I struggle with normal English. It's like learning another language, and once you understand it, it's at first the same way as Ella, I was like, but then, because even though I don't speak a lot in the show, I also need to understand what they're talking, and it's in order to react and to be part of the scene.
Yeah.
So I think it's really interesting. Once you understand what the characters are saying on stage, it makes everything more truthful.
Yeah.
And
it's nice.
Yeah, it's really nice, and I enjoy it so much.
So just speaking to that then, to any of you, are you able now to go to any Shakespeare piece of work and understand it, or do you still...
Just let me repeat the question so the folks at home can hear it. The question was, since they've had this experience doing a Shakespeare play, can they now go to any Shakespeare and understand it?
It's more familiar. It gets more familiar.
Yeah,
the more you do, familiar. It gets easier in your mouth, like all the iambic pentameter becomes easier to say.
but I would say you have to do your table work every time. Yeah. Because you're going to come across words that are really
old
and different, and different, and phrases that you don't quite understand, so you always have to do your table.
And that experts sometimes don't even understand. Like they're like, debate so-and-so things. Thinks that this means this, but it's actually like this.
Yes, absolutely.
All right. For me as a mature student, this might be my fifth or sixth Shakespeare. And like, yes, there are things that become more familiar over time. But at the same time, you do have, it really helps to take it from a new perspective, because it's not one Shakespearean character. Like, it's full, his plays are universes and worlds within their own, and you can't tackle a ghost the same way you can a clown. They're completely different. And it takes a little time and effort just to be able to let that sink into you and under the skin and to be able to breathe it. So.
The other thing too is, I mean, even if like this entire cast, for whatever reason, was given a new director and said, okay, start from scratch, it would not be the same at all. Each thing would be different. So I mean, a different Shakespeare show would be completely different. Mm-hmm. And even if we did Hamlet again, it would be different than this, just because of a different perspective.
Yeah.
So I think even if you study Shakespeare in English, it's different than putting it on the stage or reading it a second time after not reading it for 3 years. So any new thing, it's gonna be different no matter how many times you've experienced it or studied it or heard it or read it. It's always different and it's always something new. But like Brooke said, just table work. Hopefully understand what you're saying.
In a bit of a general way, so table work, for those who are at home, is exactly what it sounds like. It's work around the table, discussing what's going on. Doing table work of any Shakespearean show does give you certain tools that you can use to tackle other shows. One that I would say almost every director uses is what you'll call the long thought. And it's one of the ways of breaking up that wall of text into something more manageable. The long thought, for us, could be a long sentence or a sentence at all. Something that is truncated by a period has meaning and understanding that can help you break up Shakespeare. So whether it's Coriolanus or Hamlet or Caesar or Pericles, that's what we're picking up. You can gain these tools over time, as Matt said, to help you break apart that wall of text and find that human underneath.
Okay, we have two questions. We'll take these two and then maybe we'll call it a night. So start, yes?
So the question and comment about the ghost and the gravedigger. One sort of sets Hamlet off on this journey of revenge and death. And the other sort of makes Hamlet aware and a little more comfortable with the idea of death. And you're playing by the same person. Was that on purpose, or is that just something?
There's
there is
a tradition. There's a lot of doubling in these plays. And that is one double that is done frequently, partly just technically because it's possible.
Yep.
The person playing the ghost can also play the gravedigger. And I think it also, for the reasons that you say, it's a fun double to have.
Yeah.
So it's a bit of both.
And just to repeat the question, the question was, the person who played the ghost, Matt over here, also played the grave digger, and was that decided on purpose? Was the question, did the director decide that on purpose? And I just want to add to that you remember that Shakespeare was an actor. He knew how the stage worked, and he knew what could double where. And there are some scholars that actually have written what theses on what the doubling in Shakespeare's time would be.
And I think Shakespeare played that double himself. Yeah.
There you go, Matt.
So there you go.
You were Shakespeare.
Big shoes to fill.
Robin.
Maybe you guys kept talking about how tell me the question again.
Do you understand what I mean? It's an exercise.
The do you understand what I mean exercise, yeah. Yes, okay. This is an exercise that Jeanette uses in her acting classes, and it's called the do you understand what I mean exercise. Cool.
There's a technique that Jeanette uses to help get an understanding of what the other person is saying in the scene to you after you figured out what you're already saying yourself. And so what happens in this exercise is the other person says their line or whatever they're going to say to you, and then you say, do I understand you to mean? And then you paraphrase what that person says in your own words. So you wouldn't do it in a Shakespearean language, rhetoric or whatever. You would just say it in your own words. And if you get it, you can continue. And it kind of gets the whole scene into your bones and into your body. Sets a nice foundation for all the nice things that go
and
over the top.
To add on that, I know I had trouble with this exercise in the one of the first scenes. I think it was after we saw the ghost and we were talking about it. And it forces you to listen so closely. Like you, I think it was you. I was listening to you telling me about how you've encountered my father, the ghost, and he's walking dead in the night. And he said the long thought, and I was really listening, listening. And then I'd be like, no, I don't got it. Let's go again. your ears literally feel like they're opening and. Once you got it, though, it informs what you're just about to say.
Yeah.
And that happened, interestingly enough, when, I can't even, my brain's on fire, but it happened, and that informed me to say a line differently because of it.
Yes.
I think it was in my mind's eye ratio. That was the moment, and I was like, what are you talking about? In my mind's eye?
What I love about that exercise is that in addition to getting people to understand what the text is truly about, it also really trims the fat of the text, and your thoughts become really focused.
Yeah.
And I just want to make one more comment about that, and that is for all of you folks out there who are maybe thinking about someday becoming an actor, pick up any script at all, even Hamlet, highlight all your lines in bright pink, and then tell me how much of the script is pink and how much of the script is white.
Oh, yeah.
And then you'll start to understand how important listening is.
Yes.
Okay, we have to stop because people have to do laundry and all that kind of stuff. So thank you so much for coming out. Thank you for some excellent questions. Thank you, folks at home. We would love to hear what you thought of this, the good and the bad, because we would like to do this again. This is our first time. You're the first guinea pigs. So if you have any comments to give us at all, you can
email
us. You can email me if you want. I'm sure Pamela, who is sending me all the answers to all the questions, or sending me all the questions from you guys, is going to say, no, email me. But email me, because I want to know. And my email is jetiennee@grenville.mun.ca. I'll say that again. jetiennee@grenville.mun.ca. I hope to hear from you. I hope my emails are flooded tomorrow morning. All right. Thank you again so very much for coming. Thank you for watching at home.